publishing title, Molecular Insights into Electrical Double Layers in Graphene-Based Supercapacitors. And today's talk will be organized as three parts, as the introduction and detailed information. And in the end, I will make a brief conclusion of this talk. Okay, so as we all know, today, renewable energy, such as solar energy and wind energy, they are very promising for both electricity and some interested applications. However, for both solar and wind energy, they are all intermittent, so which may decrease the stability and the reliability of the power grid. So the energy storage is very important. And on the other hand, some electrical devices, such as the satellites and the electrical vehicles and our cell phones, they all had electricity to power. So the electrical energy storage device is actually a key component for such for the implementation of such tools and devices. And as for the energy storage device, we may think of the traditional batteries, right? And even the electrochemical capacitance or even the fuel cells. However, recently, supercapacitor has become a new class of electrical energy storage device, actually which is mentioned by previous speakers already, due to their high performance. And when a potential is applied between the two electrodes of a supercapacitor, the anion and cation will migrate into the both positively charged electrode and negatively charged electrode. And you can see the electrode double layers will form at the electrode-electrolyte interface. So this mechanism provides supercapacitors several key features, such as long lifetime or the wide operating temperature. And they have significantly high power density than most batteries. Well, however, they have their own limitation. That is, for supercapacitor, it has limited or moderate energy density compared with the batteries. So, well, in other words, you can see if one can improve the energy density of a supercapacitor, it can be an excellent electrical energy storage device. And we know the energy density of a supercapacitor can be simply divided by this equation. So from this equation, we know we have some strategies, right? Like we can increase the electrode surface area, or we can increase the normalized capacitance, and we can even enlarge the range of the working potential. This strategy seems to be simple. However, their implementations rely on both the exploration of the advanced material for both electrode and electrolyte, and more important is the fundamental understanding of the electrode double layers at the interface. So generally speaking, there are three types of electrolytes used in supercapacitors. The common electrolyte is as the aqueous electrolyte or the organic electrolyte. And recently, room temperature ionic liquids have become a promising electrolyte used in supercapacitors due to their quite wide electrochemical window and some other unique features such as the excellent stability and the non-volatility. And actually, in particular, their quite wide electrochemical window can help to improve the energy density of the supercapacitor. And with respect to the electrode, carbon has become the most widely used electrode material due to the high specific surface area, good electrical conductivity, chemical stability, and relatively low cost. And actually today, diverse forms of carbon have been developed or used in supercapacitors, such as the graphite, amorphous carbon, or anion-like carbons, and even carbon nanotubes. So in our research, actually we are using molecular modelings to investigate the interface between ionic liquids and the carbon electrode. Well, based on the geometry of the electrode, we can usually category the electrode as the endohedral type, which means actually the ion can enter the pores of the electrode, or the extrahedral type, which means the ion is outside the electrode, and the planar type, which means the curvature of the electrode is zero, such as the graphene. Well, notice that actually for a real electrode, right, it usually composes of all those three simple types of electrode. It is very, so actually, however, in simulation, we usually model one of such simple electrodes to investigate the specific phenomena in supercapacitor. So by using these modeling methods, we have studied different types of ionic liquid-based supercapacitors with electrode layers. So in part one, let's focus on the planar carbon electrode at first. Actually, for the planar electrodes, many works have been reported and focused on the interface between ionic liquids and the planar carbon electrode. And both theoretical and experimental methods showed that the interfacial cation anion exhibit layering phenomena, as it's shown here. And in addition, the differential capacitance of the electrode double layers in ionic liquids have also been widely studied. You can see the concave CV curve have been observed in many experiments, whereas the bell shape and the camera-like shape CV curve have also been reported. And since the interface between ionic liquids and planar carbon electrodes are truly molecular phenomena, so molecular dynamic simulation is very useful in showing their microstructure properties. So here, put it simply, we model different types of ionic liquids near the planar carbon electrode, which is modeled by three sheets of graphene. And by these modelings, we can get some properties such as how ionic liquids will distribute near the electrode. And first, as you can see, the layering of the ionic liquid, or the ion, is inconsistent with previous results. And second, as you can see, as the electrode becomes more negative or more negative, the first peak of the cation increases as well. Actually, once we can get such detailed information of the microstructure, we can make a comparison between the MD simulations results and the experimental results, which were obtained by atomic force microscopy here. So in that time, there was an issue that some people think the tip of the AFN cannot penetrate the first adsorbed ionic liquid layer, because they think the first adsorbed layer is somehow like solid. Well, some other groups think the first layer can be penetrated. And actually, by the comparison of our simulation results and experiments, we could make a conclusion that the tip can penetrate the first layer. The tip can penetrate. So why? For example, if the tip cannot penetrate, all the peaks we show here will shift to the region here. And in that case, except for the first peak, all other peaks cannot match with the experiments anymore. So you can see the integration of the MD simulation and the AFM technique can help us better understand the charge storage mechanism of the electrode layer for multiple applications. And we also studied different types of ionic liquid here with different cation and anion. And we found the tip actually has ion selectivity. And this selectivity depends weakly on the tip's own properties, such as the tip's radius or its material, but strongly on the ion's properties. That is, if an ion has a larger volume or mass, the tip would detect that one first. and except for the ideal planar carbon electrode, we also studied some carbon surfaces with defects. So once again, as you can see, there is a good match between the experimental results and MD simulation results. And we also studied the effect of the shape of defect. So here the shape is simply the step of the defect. So actually MD predicts that for two steps defect type, the layering of cation and anion is becomes stronger than ideal planar carbon electrodes. And for one step defect, the layering is become weaker. And due to the time limitations, I cannot give you more information about this. So actually, beyond the planar carbon electrode, we also studied the liquid-based supercapacitors on the curved carbon electrode. So in part two, I'd like to talk about how the curvature of the electrode may affect the supercapacitor. Well, in experiments, there is a new type of such curved electrode, which is called onion-like current, and has very good performance. So we modeled this type of curved electrode, as is shown here, to investigate how the curvature of such curved electrode would affect the capacitor. And actually, for the first time, we found that if you see the differential capacitance versus the applied potential curve, which is the CV curve, the CV curve is much flatter for ionic liquid near the such onion-like current than ionic liquid near the planar carbon electrode. You can see it is the CV curve is much flatter. And second, as the curvature increases, the differential capacitance increases as well. And we also studied the effect of such cylindrical curvature. Before it's the sphere electrode, right? So you can see the phenomenon is actually the same as we described before. That is, if the curvature is within nanoscale, you will have such a flat differential capacitance versus potential curve, which is dramatically different from the planar carbon electrode. So here is just a fundamental understanding or fundamental study of the supercapacitors. However, we know in reality, especially in most cases, the electrode we use is the porous carbon electrode, right? So in part three, I'd like to talk about the relation between the capacitance and the pore size. So here, it is the definition of the pore, which is based on the pore size. We can categorize the pore into macropore, mesopore, and micropore, right? And in 2006, there was a milestone paper published in Science, reported an anomalous increase in carbon capacitance at pore sizes less than 1 nanometer, as you can see here. And the same phenomenon have also been reported for both aqueous electrolytes and ionic liquid electrolytes. However, later, another group found that actually the capacitance in carbon porous of 0.7 to 15 nanometers is nearly constant. So which means in their experiments, they did not observe such the previous anomalous capacitance increase. They did not. So the simple question is, which one is right? Right? So to understand this conflicting experimental results, we use molecular dynamic simulations to investigate the relation between the capacitance and the pore size, as is shown here. And we found that in this capacitance versus pore size curve, we found that when the pore size is within 0.7 to 1 nanometer, the anomalous capacitance increase can be reproduced in MD simulation. And when pore size is less than or decreases below 0.7 nanometers, the capacitance decreases as well. And as you can see, the first peak of the simulated CD curve matches very well with the experiment. Well, as the capacitance, as the pore size increases from 1 nanometer to about 1.8 nanometer, the second peak occurs, and which is the new feature in such relationship between capacitance and pore size, and has not been reported in previous works. So based on our simulated CD curve, we could explain such conflicting experimental data. So why? For example, first in simulation, you know, we know the pore size usually has no pore size distribution, right? However, in experiment, when you talk about pore size, it is usually the average value of the pore size distribution. And if we consider the pore size distribution is following some simple distribution such as Gaussian distribution, we found that as the pore size distribution becomes wider, actually the CD curve becomes less defined, as it's shown here. So in other words, if one make your electrode with a quite narrow pore size distribution, you can observe the anomalous capacitance increase in your experiment. And if you make your electrode with a quite wide pore size distribution, you may not observe such anomalous capacitance increase. And based on this theory, we checked previous paper for their supporting information, and we found that their experimental data is inconsistent with what we described here. And in another work, our experiments collaborators found that during the charging and discharging process of a supercapacitor, the porous carbon electrode will expand. And to understand such phenomenon, we use modelings to model for both small size pore and large size pore. And you can see for both small size pore and large size pore, they have the same trend for the relation between the pressure. Actually, there is a parabolic relation between the pressure on the carbon surfaces and the applied tension. They have the same trend. So, and this is consistent with the experimental data. And from MD simulations, we could find the pressure exerted on the electro surfaces came from the Van der Waals and Coulombic interaction between the ionic liquids and the electrode. So in the last part of today's talk, I'd like to talk about a practical issue in such ionic liquid-based supercapacitors. We know ionic liquid is a promising electrolyte. However, there is a shortcoming. That is, actually, it is very difficult to completely remove the water from ionic liquid, because lots of ionic liquid is hydrophilic. And if there is a little water, the electrochemical window of the ionic liquid may become much narrower than we expect it to be. So what we want to investigate here is, if there is little water in the ionic liquid, where is the water in the electrode layers, and how the water will affect the supercapacitor? And we use modelings to understand this. So here you can see, here is the distribution of the water molecules, the black line, and the ion distribution, the red and the blue line. And from this figure, we can know that actually, water can be absorbed on the electrode surfaces. And also, as the applied potential increases, you can see the peak of the water, the first peak of the water increases as well. And actually, for overall picture, we found this trend for the accumulated water and the applied potential. That is, for both positively charged electrode and negatively charged electrode, with the increasing applied potential, more water can absorb on the, or can accumulate on the electrode surface. And for this particular type ionic liquid, we found there is an asymmetrical behavior of such water absorption. So here is the conclusion of today's talk. Actually, for planar electrode, we show the combination of ASM technique and MD simulation for better understanding of the charge storage mechanism. And for curved electrode, we show that the MD predicts nearly constant differential patterns with potential, which is dramatically different from the planar carbon electrode. And for porous electrodes, in the first case, we show that the oscillatory CD curve revealed by MD offers a possible explanation for the experimental data. And in second case, we can see the height change of all electrodes and the pressure on the electrodes follows parabolic curves as a function of the potential during charging and discharging. And for the humid ionic liquid, we found that the enrichment of water near the electrode as the applied potential increases is likely a universal phenomenon in electrode bodies formed by ionic liquids with ions larger than water molecules. So in the end, I'd like to appreciate for our excellent collaborators and my colleagues. I also want to thank for the funding support and computer resources. Thank you very much for